Church, you stand with us this morning. Let's sing of our victory. In the name of Jesus.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
You believe it?
Good morning, Northridge family. How are we doing this morning? Good. Good to see you. Thank you so much for being here with us, whether you're watching online or whether you're here in person. We would like to say thank you. Thank you for coming. For our first-time guests, we'd like to say welcome home. We're glad that you're here. So, Northridge members, Northridge family, if y'all would put your hands together for our guests this morning. Amen. Thank y'all for being here. Got to meet several families. Awesome. Well, in view of coming up Veterans Day, we're honoring our veterans today. So if you are a veteran, if you have served our great country in any branch of the military, if you would remain standing, everyone else, please have a seat. We would love to put our hands together and show some love to all of our veterans in the house. Amen. Come on, church. Thank you guys so very much. Thank you so very much. We appreciate your service. We want to honor you. You may be seated. Thank you very much. If this is your first time, if you haven't had a chance to connect with us yet or us exchange information so we can follow up with you and keep you plugged in on what's going on and different events and different things that are coming up, just grab that blue Connect card right there in the back of that seat in front of you. Fill it out. You can drop it off here in the offering plate here in just a moment. But we'd love to have a record of you visiting with us, and that way we can stay keep you plugged in on what's happening. One more, a couple, few more people we'd like to honor this morning. If I do call your name, just quickly stand. And we'll give a big round of applause for everyone at the end here. But this past couple weeks, several different counties represented our students from our Northridge family. Young ladies have been a part of the homecoming court in several different counties. So I'm going to shout out the county and the people that were part of that homecoming court. And we just want to love on you. Just say congratulations. Thank you so much for all that you've been doing. From Upson Lee, Miss Madison Murphy, Miss Josie Perdue, and Miss Madison Clark. Y'all give the Upson Lee folks a round of applause. From Harris County, Miss Carly Franklin. Y'all give Miss Carly a round of applause from Harris County. And then Pike County, Miss Olivia Mitchell. Miss Olivia, y'all show some love to our Pike County Pirates. And then last but not least, we had our homecoming queen from Upson Lee. Y'all show some love to Miss Mackenzie Fry. Amen, amen. Awesome. Awesome. Congratulations. A lot of those students attended the first service, but we want to brag on them and just say congratulations in both services. Make a big deal out of that. That's really cool. So that's awesome. Pastor Mark is preaching out of state today. He's in the good state of Oklahoma. So Pastor Mark is preaching the word. We miss him. If he's watching online, we miss you, Pastor Mark. I pray that you have a great, great time where you're at and lives are changed. People's lives are impacted. But today we have a very special honored guest with us to be speaking, to be bringing the word. The Great Comeback is the title of his new book, and that's his message this morning. We're super excited to have an ex-pro boxer, Mr. Ebo Elder. So y'all go ahead and welcome him. Show some love. He's going to be coming out later after we finish our worship. But we're just super excited about Pastor Ebo Elder, and he's going to unpack his testimony, boxing, and God's calling on his life. Super, super great guy. We love having him. It was really, really awesome this morning for the 9 a.m. service, and we know God's going to do something great this morning too. Amen. So I'm going to go ahead and pray, and after I pray, that's going to cue our Veterans Day video. You guys can stay seated for that, but please just pay attention to that. A lot of you guys have submitted loved ones, family, and friends that have served our great country, so we want to honor them this morning on the video. But as the video is going, y'all please come feel forward to bring your tithes and your offerings this morning as we bring our tithes and offerings to sow into God's kingdom. We're super excited about that. Amen. So I'm going to pray, and we're going to do this awesome video, and we'll just pray and ask God to bless our time of giving. Amen. Lord Jesus, we love you. God, I just pray that that you would just continue to bless, Lord, this time of giving. God, that you would continue to just pour out your grace, Lord, and your mercy on our homes, on our families. God, we lift up our great country to you, Lord. I pray, God, you just continue to bless us, God, as we serve you, Lord. And God, this morning as we talked and we prayed before church even started, God, it's not about us. It's all to you, Lord Jesus. It's all about you. It's your glory, your honor. So God, I pray that you would just, as we live our life each and every day, God, I pray that you would give us opportunities to serve. Give us opportunities to share our faith. Give us opportunities, Lord, just to other people see our actions and they point and they look to Jesus. We thank you for our veterans, Lord. We thank you, God, for them serving our great country. Pray, God, you bless them and their families. We bless this time of offering, Lord, that you would use these funds to further expand your kingdom. Be with Pastor Ebo as he brings a message this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. All God's people said, amen. Thank you, guys.
I'm just trying to be a father, raise a daughter and a son, be a lover to their mother, everything to everyone. Up and at 'em bright and early, I'm all business in my suit. Yeah, I'm dressed up for success, from my head down to my boots. I don't do it for the money, there's bills that I can't pay. I don't do it for the glory, I just do it anyway. Providing for our futures, my responsibility. Yeah, I'm real good on the pressure, being all that I can be. I can't call in sick on Mondays when the weekend's been too strong. I just work straight through the holidays, sometimes all night long. You can bet that I stand ready when the wolf growls at the door. Hey, I'm solid, hey, I'm steady, hey, I'm true down to the core. And I will always do my duty, no matter what the price. I've counted up the cost, I know the sacrifice. Oh, and I don't wanna die for you, but if dying's asking me, I'll bear that cross with honor, 'cause freedom don't come free. I'm an American soldier, an American, beside my brothers and my sisters, I will proudly take a stand. When liberty's in jeopardy, I will always do what's right. I'm out here on the front lines, sleep in peace tonight. American soldier,
if tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston,
heart, and it's time we stand and say
that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free.
Y'all give it up one more time for our veterans this morning. Please stand with us. Honor our veterans. Amen. This time we're going to continue in worship, and we do want to invite, just remind you guys, we've got our offering plates down here, and we encourage you to take this time and let it be your worship, where you reflect on all God's given to you and trusted you with, and let's continue and sing to the name above all names. Amen. Let's worship.
Darkness now has ended, and the kingdom of light, and the kingdom of light, forever under your dominion. You're the king of my life, you're the king of my life, and you reign above it all. You reign above it all.
You believe that?
And on the cross his work was finished. Oh, he poured out his life just to give us new life. So from the lips of the forgiven, hear this anthem arise. Jesus, you're alive.
Church, come on, listen to these words of hope.
You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, and I seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, and I seated alone in glory. He's enthroned on the highest praise. You sing. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. And you sent the darkness running.
Thank you, Jesus. Come on, it didn't stop at the cross.
Now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, now seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sent the darkness running out of an empty grave, seated alone in glory, enthroned on the highest praise. You sing, you reign. Over the universe and over everything. is sovereign over all, over our hearts, over our families. You reign above it all. Name of names, Jesus, you sing. You reign above it all, you reign above it all. And over the universe and over every heart, there is no higher name. 'Cause Jesus, you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and this church erupt in song. Hallelujah. Sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. You reign above it all. You're sovereign over this country, and you reign above it all. Would you lift up a shout of praise this morning? The hope we have, but not just the finished work on the cross that our penalties paid for, but the hope we have by the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. When he's defeated death, he's defeated the sting of sin, the victory of the grave. He swallowed it up in his love and his resurrection power. You know, those words of hope can ring true in your soul this morning like they ring true in mine. That I have an eternal hope by that resurrection power of Jesus Christ, the name above all names, the name at which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess his lordship, his sovereignty, his deity. I just wonder if you'd join me one more time in your life, if you'd sing it over maybe the anxieties and stresses that you have and trust in the sovereign hope that is the name of Jesus. Let's sing together. And you reign above it all, you reign above it all. And over the universe and over every yard, there is no higher name. 'Cause Jesus, you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and this church erupt in song. Sing hallelujah to everlasting one. There is no higher name. Sing it. Jesus, you reign above it all. Give him his praise one more time in the house this morning. Let's continue to lift up that name.
You make all things new. The name gives life, Jesus, Jesus, over all. The name gives hope, the name gives life, Jesus, Jesus, lifted.
Up one more shout of praise for the name of Jesus. Amen. He's worthy.
Elder, to the left, another left. Crowd standing up, a lot of people here. It's a sellout crowd, Santa Ynez. Final round. And goes Orthodox. Trying to unzip.
Round 7, 8, 9, I thought Burton was slowing down. He really came on. I thought he took the last two, and it's a good thing that the way in.
Oh, Elder with a left hand, and Burton is in big trouble, holding on for his life here. Stevie's not going to make it. There goes the left. Ebo Elder. 3, 4, 5, 6, are you all right? He's out on his feet, it looks like, Steve. Out on his feet. He barely lifted his legs when the referee asked him, but you got to stop it. There's the left. An unbelievable, stunning turn of events. Reversal of fortune. Burton is flat on his back. Blood streaming from the right eye as we look in. Victorious, Ebo Elder. Nick, you know what? Ebo Elder right now is praying to God, and that's fine, but he should also be praying for his opponent. That left hand by Ebo Elder, again and again and again. Wow, what a finish. Elder was headed for victory on the cards.
Lord, I thank you for this gladiator, this man with such heart, such skill, such determination. I pray that you make this loss for him a benefit like you did for me 3.5 years ago, God. Make it the best thing that ever happened to him so that he'll turn his life completely to you, God. And he'll understand nothing in his actions is worth anything. Only a relationship with you, the Father, the God of the earth. That's all that matters, Lord. I pray that you touch his heart. making that no pain, no hurt, no misunderstanding. And letting know that I love him as a brother in Christ. Yeah. In his name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Great fight, man.
You bad dude, man. You bad dude, man. You bad.
All right.
Everybody.
Everybody.
There's a plan Jesus Christ has for your life. Yeah. Just accept it. Get him into it.
Chilling moment. Man.
Well, it's always good to watch boxing in church. Yeah. Hope you guys enjoyed that. It's great to be here with you. Appreciate your pastor, Pastor Mark, inviting me to share. And had a great first service, man. I hope you guys are excited, expecting God to speak to us. Amen? Right on, right on. Well, let's go ahead and do this, man. Let's bow our hearts and head and just ask the Lord to meet us in this place. Father, we thank you so much for being so good to us. We thank you, Lord, for your immeasurable, infinite love for us, your grace and your mercy and your forgiveness. Lord, we invite you into this place. We ask you to speak to our hearts, to soften our hearts, Lord, that the seed of your word might be planted and produce good, lasting fruit in our lives. So, Lord, meet us in this place, we ask. In Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank the online audience. If you're online and checking out the service, appreciate you joining us, as well as the Bear 92.5. Thank you for tuning in, guys. I'm going to share a little bit of my story today, actually a lot of my story with you. I'm going to share some about that boxing match you just saw the clip of. And but first, we live in interesting times, don't we? Am I at the wrong church? No, I'm at the right church. We live in interesting times, don't we? I mean, I've never personally, in 41 years, I've never seen what I see going on in our nation. So much division, so much discord, so much, just chaos going on in America. It's really, I might have had to convince you that life was hard a year ago, but I doubt I'd have to convince you of that now. Life is hard. Life just is difficult. And I don't mean to start off on a bad note with you guys, but life is tough. Anybody relate? Maybe you're going through a tough season. Personally, I've went through some of the toughest things I've ever experienced this year. Although I think 2020 has been the greatest year of my life, to be honest, but it's been some tough seasons too. We live in interesting times. My English teacher in high school, Miss Bradbury, she had something she said all the time. She'd say, in response to my complaining about something not being fair, she would say, well, Ebo, life's hard, and then you die. She wasn't an optimist very much. But she was a realist, I would say, because, truth is, life is hard, and then you die, right? I mean, that's the truth of it. No, these guys are, they're not getting it over here. It's okay. Look, guys, life is hard. I don't know, if it's not hard yet, just start following Jesus for about 10 minutes, and it's going to get hard, I promise you. Why? Because Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. You're going to have trouble. You're going to have tribulations. You're going to have difficulty. Life's going to be hard. Hey, but be of good cheer. Jesus said, for I've overcome the world. So life is hard, and then you die. Now, for the Christian, it doesn't stop there. The day that I die will be the greatest day of my life. Because at that moment, I leave this body to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. And I will then experience life as God intended it for the very first time. So I'm looking forward to it, man. God's got work for me for the time being. But when it's the time, I'm ready. Life is hard, and then you die. Maybe you're in a tough season right now. I would suspect that many of you guys are in a challenging situation, one way or the other. As we go through this life journey with Jesus, like he promised, trouble will come. Sometimes we get knocked down. Sometimes we get beat up a little bit. Sometimes you feel like I looked in that boxing match, right? And that might be you now. Maybe you feel like I look there. Beat up on the mat. I want to encourage you guys. maybe if you're on the mat right now and you feel like there's no hope and you can't make it and you can't keep going, I want you to know I believe that God has a great comeback in store for you. A great comeback. That's right. The title of my message today is The Great Comeback, Five Keys to Your Comeback. I'm going to give you five keys today. These five keys, I promise you, if you'll apply these to your life, these five keys will transform your life. No ifs, ands, or buts. It will transform your life. The good news, there's a passage in the Bible that I really love. It's got some boxing context to it. It's Proverbs 24:16. It says, although a righteous man falls seven times, he will get up. Although a righteous man falls seven times, he will get up. What's that mean? That means although we get knocked down, right? Although we get knocked down and we go to the mat as Christians, as Christ followers, we are never knocked out. Amen? You're never out. You're never out. I'm gonna give you these five keys to your comeback as I walk you through the boxing match that you just saw the clip of. So we go back to the end of 2003. I had walked away from the Lord. I had left boxing. I thought my career was over. And God intervened into my life, into 2003. He intervenes into my life, and I know he's going to call me back to boxing at some point. But so I start watching a little bit of boxing, and I saw this one fight. It was between a guy named Angel Manfredi and Courtney Burton. And I had heard of Angel Manfredi. He's a very good fighter. And I watched in this fight something I did not imagine would happen. Courtney just walked through Angel Manfredi, you know, just destroyed him. And I'm sitting there watching that boxing match, and I cry out to God, Lord, when you call me back to boxing, when I box again, please don't ever make me have to fight that guy. So fast forward, a couple months after that, God called me back into the sport, end of 2004. Now about a year and a half after I saw that boxing match, Showtime Boxing calls us. And they call us, we live in Noonan, Georgia at the time. They call us, they say, hey guys, we want you to fight on our network. Ebo's an exciting fighter. And he throws lots of punches. And he bleeds a lot. And that's good for ratings, apparently. And I do bleed a lot, so yeah. But we knew what God had called us to. I knew that God had called me to something bigger than me, right? My life was devoted to the Lord. My career was devoted to God. I knew he called me to something bigger than me. So we told Showtime, they sent us a list of opponents, guys I should beat. We said, we don't want any of these guys. You go to the world champion and you challenge him. You go to the next guy. If he won't give us a fight, go to the next guy. If he won't give us, go to the next guy. We said, get us the toughest fight you can possibly get us, because I knew God called me to something bigger than me. Look, guys, the same is true for you. Guess what? God has called you to a life bigger than you. You know that? Yeah. He's called you to a life bigger than you, something far bigger than you could ever imagine or ask or conceive. He's called you to that, because that way when it comes to fruition, you don't get the credit for it. He does, right? So I said, look, you challenged the world champion. So they did. They challenged him. They challenged the next guy. I hadn't earned a fight with the top three, but they get to the number four ranked guy in the world. And his name? Courtney Burton. And he accepted the fight. And when I heard that, man, I was bummed. The one guy that I feared in the whole world is the guy that I have to fight. The one guy that I pray, God, don't let me have to fight that guy. God made me fight that guy. I think that's comical. Anyway. So Courtney accepted the fight. I was bummed, but I get to the point where I have to sign the contract. And I sign the fight contract, and immediately God gifted me with faith. He gave me faith. You know, faith isn't something we work up in the flesh. It's not something we manifest within ourselves. Faith is the gift of God. And when I signed the contract, when I made a commitment to the fight, God gifted me with faith. And from that moment on, I had no doubts that I would win the fight. Not one doubt. So fast forward a few months of training, preparation. We fly out to San Ynez, California, Chumash Indian Casino. We go into the main event of the night, 12-round championship fight. ding, ding, the fight starts. First round, second round, early on in the fight, I began to realize some important information. I was in way over my head. I knew it. I was going to get beat up and probably knocked out right there on live worldwide boxing television. And look, if I'm going to get beat up and knocked out, I don't mind it so much in the alley behind the local Walmart. You just get up and go home. It's okay. But this is going to happen on worldwide boxing television. That's the last thing I want to have happen. So all I knew to do at that moment, I knew Courtney was bigger, meaner, stronger. I knew I didn't have what it took to win the fight. I knew my corner couldn't help me. My wife couldn't help me. The fans couldn't help me, right? But I knew God could. So I cried out to the Lord. I said, Lord, this fight's going to be brutal. It's going to be brutal. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be painful. And I admitted to God my weakness. I said, Lord, I don't have what it takes to win this. I just don't have the goods. And I admitted my weakness to God. I said, God, I'm going to want to quit. I know I'm going to want to give up. And when I said that to the Lord, he spoke back, you know, not audibly, but it was something as clear as I've ever heard. He said, Ebo, if you don't quit, I'll do what you can't do. Come on. You guys awake? It's 11 o'clock service. Come on. If you don't quit, I'll do what you can't do. You know, he says the same thing to you guys. If you don't quit, if you'll stay the course, I'll do what you can't do. So the first key to your comeback is perseverance. Perseverance. I hope you guys are taking notes. Studies show we remember 10% of what we hear, right? You guys want to take some notes? Get out your phones. Anyway, that's up to you. First key to your comeback, perseverance. It's John 15:5. John 15:5, Jesus says, I'm the vine, you're the branch. He who abides in me bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. The word abide there in the original language literally means to remain in, to continue in, to remain in relationship with Jesus, to continue in the study of God's word, to continue in prayer, to continue in corporate fellowship, to continue serving, to continue being a witness of Jesus Christ, abiding in him. And guys, we have to abide. We have to remain. We have to persevere in the faith. When you became a Christian, you know, I know you wanted to board a cruise ship, right? You didn't board a cruise ship. You boarded a battleship, right? That's right. It's a battleship. Now, you know, when you became a Christian, you were already in a battle. You were losing the battle before you put your faith in Jesus. But after you put your faith in Jesus, you went to the front lines, and you were in a battle. And battles are difficult by definition. You're in a fight, as Paul would say to Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. And a fight is not easy by definition. So what do we have to do? We have to persevere. We have to keep going. The first key to your comeback is perseverance. So when God said he would do what I couldn't do if I didn't quit, I was filled with joy. Why? Because I knew at that moment I would win. Not only would I win, but I would win by knockout. And I knew it'd be a knockout victory because, you know, I've never seen God leave a decision up to the judges, right? It's not his style. He doesn't do that. So I knew I would win by knockout. But like most of you guys, I assume, I wanted the victory to come quick and easy, right? Don't we all want that? Quick, easy victories? Well, it wasn't, if you didn't notice by the video. About the second or third, fourth round, I got hit with a body shot causing my kidneys to start hemorrhaging. I was internally bleeding. About round 6 or 7, I got hit with a right hand that broke my jaw. Rounds kept going, eyes swelling shut, cuts over both of them, bleeding everywhere. Look, after the 11th round, I was completely beat up and had nothing left. Maybe that's how you feel today. I don't know. But at the 11th round, at the 11th round rest, my corner started to pray for me. Maybe if you watch the YouTube video, you'll see it. They started to pray for me, and they prayed an interesting prayer. He said, Lord God, give him strength to do whatever he has to do. Because I really didn't know what I had to do at that point. I thought I might have to die in the 12th round and be resurrected from the dead on Showtime. I'm not even joking. I was completely prepared to die on Showtime and be resurrected from the dead. My God's the same today as he was 2,000 years ago. Anyway. But I didn't know what he was going to do in the 12th round. And the truth is, guys, we live in the 11th round. That's where you're at right now. You're in the 11th round. And you don't get to see what God's going to do in the 12th round. You don't see what he does next week or next month or next year to give you victory in your life. You don't see how it pans out. But I knew that, God would reward my commitment to him, those 11 rounds. He would reward it in the 12th. And the same is true for you. God will reward your commitment to him, your obedience, your surrenderedness. He'll reward your surrenderedness this year, next year. He'll reward your obedience to him this week, next week. That's the way God works. That's the way he works. He'll reward it later. That's the principles of reaping and sowing, right? You always reap what you sow. You always reap after you sow. And you always reap more than you sow. Now, I'm in Thomaston, or Meansville, rather. So you guys got any farmers in here? Okay, maybe. I'm heading out to Iowa in a couple weeks. Nebraska, there we go. Okay. Well, farming illustrations, I guess they don't work in Thomaston either, but that's the principles of reaping and sowing. But I knew I couldn't quit. I knew I couldn't give up. I had to keep going. So going to the 12th round, a minute and a half later, Courtney hits me with a big right hand, and I'm hurt, and I fall back into the ropes. And my instinct was to throw a left hand, but as I did, it was held back by one of the ring ropes. You can watch it on YouTube. And all my energy drained out of me, and I started to go down. And as I started to go down, I cried out to God again. I said, "Lord, I'm about to get knocked out on Showtime." I said, "It's about to be over, Lord." I knew it. I knew as soon if I could even stand up, Courtney was going to knock me out. And I said, "God, I'm about to get knocked out, but Lord, I didn't quit. I didn't quit. Not only did I not quit, I didn't even think about quitting since you made that promise to me in the second round. I haven't thought about quitting since." And the second key to your comeback, the first is perseverance. The second, perspective. Perspective. It's Proverbs 23:7 says, "For as a man or woman thinks in his heart, so is he." Listen, I'm going to give you This transformed my life more than anything else was recognizing that the way I think determines everything. It determines my identity, my worldview, everything I hold to be true and right. The way I think determines that. Now, I don't know about you, but if you look at that verse, I don't think with my heart. I think with my mind. You too, right? We think with our mind. But as we meditate and dwell on thoughts, what happens? They take root in our heart. And the things that take root in our heart dictate our worldview and our identity and our whole belief system. So what we have to do, guys, we have to start filtering every thought we have through the Word of God. You see, the Bible says there's a way into a man he believes is right, but it leads to death. How do we know the difference? If we think it's right, what we do is we filter it through the Word of God. And what is not of God, as Jesus said, you take it captive. When Jesus said to take your thoughts captive, that was a military term, speaking of a prisoner of war in a battle. And he said, look, when you have a thought that's untrue and unrighteous and impure, you take those, filter them through the Word of God, and if they're not of the Lord, you take them captive, and you don't dwell on them, you don't meditate on them. On the other hand, the Bible says that things that are pure and praiseworthy and true and righteous, those things we dwell on, we meditate, we fill our mind with those things, and then they take root in our heart, and the result is a worldview and a life and an identity based on truth and in Jesus Christ. Amen? That's what we got to do, church. We have to do that. Perspective is key to your comeback. So I said, Lord, I haven't thought about quitting. And I took that thought captive. And I said, I'm not going to think about it now. So I gathered together all the strength I possibly could. All I had, just enough to stand up. That's all I could do, right? Maybe you feel like that's you this morning. Just all you can do is stand up. And when I got to my feet, power came into my body. And, you know, Steve Farhood, the commentator, he noticed it. He said, you know, Ebo's got a burst of steam. Yeah, right? Burst of steam, where'd that come from? I had nothing left. What he thought was a burst of steam was, in fact, the power of the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus said, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. That word power is dunamis. We get the word dynamite and dynamic from it. It's a powerful word, right? The third key to your comeback is power. Power, the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Look, guys, if you're going to make it to your comeback, if you're going to live a successful Christian life, it cannot be done in the flesh. You cannot will the Christian life. You have to depend upon the power of God to do it. You see, when the church of God tries to do the work of God outside of the power of God, it never works. It just doesn't. You'll fail enough times that eventually you'll just give up altogether. I've seen it too many times. What we have to do is depend upon the power of God to live a life that honors God. And then when we do that, you know, when we depend upon the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead to live a life that brings God glory, when we do that and we receive by faith, guess what, man? You can do all things. You can be faithful in any situation when in Christ who gives you strength. Amen? Amen. Perspective, perseverance, perspective, and power. So I was empowered by the Holy Spirit. You know, it's not a complicated thing. Luke chapter 14 says that if we, being inherently evil, know how to give good gifts to our children, even more so, God desires to give the gift of the Holy Spirit to those who ask. It's about asking and just simply receiving by faith. Now, in that case, in the boxing match, I didn't have to ask. He knew I needed it. But when you come up on a situation where you're in a tempting situation to fall back into sin, or you're in a situation where you want to be a witness for Jesus and share with others, and you need power, you need strength, ask God. Say, Lord, Holy Spirit, come upon me in power. Come upon me in power. And receive by faith. It's that simple. Well, in the power of the Holy Spirit, all my punches began to land with precision. And 30 seconds later, the number 4 ranked fighter in the world was knocked out. So in my own strength, I was going to suffer horrible defeat. But in the strength that God provides, I had the greatest victory of my career. Which is better? You guys with me? All right. I'm just checking. Of course, victory is better. Jesus offers us all victory and freedom in the power of his Spirit. So, you know, so Courtney's out. He's on the mat. And my response, all I could do was worship God. I don't know if you noticed that. I was right there in a boxing ring in a casino. I could just worship God. That's all I could do. There wasn't a worship leader within miles of that casino, I'm sure of it, right? I'm joking. Maybe there was, but there was no songs playing. We raised holy hands. You know, it was just my immediate response to what God was doing was worship. That's all I could do, man, just worship. Raise my hands. You know, so the fourth key to your comeback, we have perseverance, perspective, power, and praise. The fourth key to your comeback is praise. Listen, our nation, the world we live in, is being wrecked with people suffering from depression and anxiety and all these things. Look, I suffered from debilitating depression for 20, 25 years of my life, ruined my life. But I have found the cure to depression. You guys ready? It's not in the bottle. I can't package it. You know what it is? It's praise. It's worship. The verse there, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 and 18. Rejoice always, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. So look, what we do, here's what we do. When depression starts to come against you, when Satan attacks you, and he does, and it still happens to me, he'll attack with depression. What do? I acknowledge the good in my life. I set up memorials of remembrance in my life that I can acknowledge the good, the blessings, how God has been good to me. And if you don't think you have anything in your life that God's been good to you, you can always look back to the cross of Calvary. Every one of us can look to the cross and go, hey, God loves me, and he's blessed me beyond my wildest imaginations because of the cross. And we can be thankful because of that. And then we direct our thanksgiving towards God in worship. Lord, thank you. You're awesome. We get our eyes off of ourselves and put them vertically towards the Lord. And when you do that, I guarantee you, you will see that depression and worship cannot coexist. They cannot coexist. Perseverance, perspective, power, praise. So I'm praising the Lord. Commentators said, well, it's great that Ebo's praying to God. He needs to pray for his opponent. I didn't hear that, but God did. Don't you think it's neat how God made it where we can't get our foot in our mouth by ourselves? So the Lord empowered me, and then he led me. And he led me to go over by Courtney and pray for him. And I get on one knee with him in the middle of the ring. And I say, Lord, I pray that you'll make this fight, this loss, a benefit for Courtney, like you did for me 3.5 years ago, that he'll turn his life completely to you and know nothing of this world satisfies, only a relationship with his creator, only a relationship with Jesus. And guys, I'm here to tell you, if you're going after anything other than Jesus, you will always come up empty. It'll always come up short. Contrary to the 1995 drama Jerry Maguire, no person can complete you, right? Y'all seen that movie, right, Jerry Maguire? Renee Zellweger, Tom Cruise, you complete me. No, you don't. Because people can't complete one another. We can complement each other, and that's a good thing, but you can't complete one another. Colossians chapter 2 says that you are complete in Christ. You're complete in Christ. Not and this or and that or Christ and something else. You're complete in Jesus alone. Looked in the cameras, I said, Jesus Christ has a plan for your life. Give into it and accept it. What a radical night, man. God did that great work in the boxing ring. And prayer, the fifth key to your comeback. We have perseverance, perspective, power, praise, and prayer. Prayer. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Verse 17 says to pray without ceasing. Guys, do you want your life, your walk with the Lord to be transformed? Commit to a daily prayer life. Charles Spurgeon said, prayer is not for the greater work. Prayer is the greater work. Prayer. Perseverance, perspective, power, praise, prayer. Five keys to your comeback. Guys, that was the greatest comeback of my boxing career. I've had lots of other comebacks. 10th grade, I was in high school. Mr. Sullivan's geometry class, trailer number 3. I think I was sitting about 5 seats back. And that's a great memory for a boxer that's been beat up a lot. So, y'all, you give me props, right? Thank you. Thank you. I'm sitting in class. A girl walks in. Her name was Amy White. I remembered her from elementary school. We were friends first through 4th grade. She walks in class. I tell the guy next to me, you better get out of that seat. He gets up. I'm just kidding. I wasn't rude. Maybe I was. But she sits down, and we start talking and really hit it off. And, you know, we dated all through high school, went to both proms together. After high school, we had a perfect plan for our relationship and our family we were going to have. I mean, We knew I was going to be a pro boxer. She's going to be a stay-at-home mom. We named all of our children in high school. All right, little nuts there, but it's okay. We had a perfect plan. It was all figured out. But we also knew God had a plan. Amy's dad's a pastor. I had been exposed to the gospel on occasion. I knew God had a plan for me. But we resisted God's plan. We, instead of yielding to God, we did what was right in our own eyes. We justified sin. We did what made sense culturally speaking. We adapted to the world. Instead of being conformed to the image of Christ, we became like the world. We did what we thought, what we felt, what we wanted. We didn't lead our heart. We followed our heart. Heart is wicked. Heart will lead you down a path of destruction. We don't follow our heart. We lead our heart through the Word of God. It makes me sad when I hear Christians say, I'm just going to follow my heart. Please don't do that. If I followed my heart, I'd have probably been in jail this morning. I mean, I don't know. Oh, man. But, you know, so we get married 3 weeks after high school graduation, 18 years old. We had this perfect future planned out, but when we got married, you know, when we had allowed sin into our relationship and justifying sin and not obeying God, what we did is we opened the door for the enemy to come in. The Bible says the enemy comes but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And that's exactly what he began doing. We had pushed the protection that God offers us away. We had pushed his protection and his presence out of our lives by sin. Now listen, nothing will ever separate you from the love of God, but sin will always separate you from the presence and protection of God every single time. And that's what we did. And Satan began to wreak havoc in our relationship. It became the most frustrating, confusing thing I had ever been through. And after only a year and a half, not even quite a year and a half, we were both miserable. Amy filed for divorce. For the first time in so long, man, I did some self-examination. And I recognized a void in my life, something missing. I was empty. I recognized this void. And, you know, a French philosopher in the 1600s named Pascal said that every human being has a God-shaped void in their soul. And I recognized that void, but I tried to fill it with all kinds of stuff. Went into the world. I tried to fill it with accomplishment and success and money and sexual immorality and all type, you know, alcohol and drugs. And I'm trying to fill it with all this stuff. The more I tried to fill it, the bigger it got. The more empty I became. I remember about 2 years into our divorce, one night, man, I hit the end of my rope. I knew I couldn't keep going on the way I was. So I cried out, man. I just got in my living room. I got down on my knees. I cried out. I said, I wish I would have said I've got to find Jesus, but I said, I got to find Amy. You know, I believed another person could complete me. Another person could fill that void, but they can't. I went to her friend Katie's house. I begged Katie to go get Amy. If I could just see her one more time or hold her hand or anything. Katie comes back to the door and says, Amy wants you to leave. She doesn't want you in her life. She said, get out of her life and leave her alone. I remember how I felt, man. I was crushed. My last resort had failed. So I drove home and I sat on the side of my bed. I'm looking at my life and I'm like, I got 60 grand in the bank. I got a brand new sports car, brand new truck, brand new house. I'm 21 years old. Everybody thinks I got the perfect life, and I hate my life. I remember I sat there and I began to think about the family I dreamed of with Amy, and I knew she'd never come back. I knew it. I began to think about boxing, and I had no motivation to ever fight again. That dream was gone. I began to think about those kids we had names picked out for. I imagine going to a playground and calling them by name, pushing them on the swings as a family. At that moment, I knew those kids would never exist. I reached in a nightstand. I pulled a 40 caliber pistol out, and I put it to my head. I remember sitting there and just, I was ready to end my life. So I started to pull the trigger. I pulled the trigger safety, and it stopped. And right when it stopped, I heard a small, still voice. And God said to me, he said, Ebo, if you don't quit, I'll do what you can't do. God told me the same thing at 21 years old, on the side of a bed, ready to end my life, that he told me 4 years later in a boxing ring in San Ynez, California, that if I wouldn't quit, he would do what I couldn't do. And when he said that, man, hope came back into my life. Hope and faith, man, I believed God. I'm going to tell you what I did. I wish I could tell you it was a black and white transformation. I never looked back. That's not my story. If you don't know it yet, I'm pretty stubborn, right? Like some of you, I'd imagine. But I began taking steps towards Jesus. I did that. I could take steps. You know, we're not called to long jump with Jesus or high jump with Jesus. We're called to walk with Jesus. You just do that a step at a time. My encouragement to you this morning is, what's your next step? The Apostle Paul said, I haven't finished the race. I haven't reached the finish line yet. So he had more steps to take. What's your next step? What's the next step you need to take to get closer to Jesus? If you'll just take it, man, you'll see. You'll just keep taking steps. Pretty soon you'll be walking with God. And that's what I did, man. I started taking steps towards the Lord, and the Lord began a process in my life. It wasn't long after that, he put me back into boxing. Took me to a number 5 world ranking. And I don't know how you beat the number 4 guy and they make you number 5. I'll let it go, though. They 3 championship belts. Put me in a reality show in 2006 called The Contender on ESPN. Had Sylvester Stallone, Sugar Ray Leonard as the host. And then January of 2007, God pulls me out of boxing and throws me into a life of Bible teaching and evangelism. The Lord's ways are not our ways. But they are higher, right? It wasn't long after that, the Lord began working in Amy's heart. That girl that had given up. She had given up. She came back into my life. We've been remarried now, coming up, and this is going to date me a little bit, but we're coming up on 20 years remarried. Oh, and the kids we had names picked out for, we got them too. We got Maddie, Abby, Gabby, and Addie. Yeah, I don't know why we did that. It's hard. It's really difficult. God did what I couldn't do because I didn't quit. Not that I earned it or deserved it, but it requires perseverance, guys. We got to make it to the moment, right? Make it to the miracle. God's got a great comeback in store for you, but you got to make it to it, right? Lots of great comebacks, man. We got emotional comebacks, psychological comebacks, comebacks from drugs and alcohol addiction, comebacks from poverty, and comebacks from pride, and all kind of comebacks, marital comebacks, and occupational comebacks. There are lots of comebacks. But I want to tell you this morning, the greatest comeback you could ever have is simply coming back to Jesus. That's the greatest comeback you could ever have. Every other comeback flows from that. God, Jesus is the God of the great comeback. I want to give you an opportunity this morning. Give you an invitation. You know, God blesses public profession. I don't know if you knew that. A lot of people down, you know, altar calls and invitations of this nature, but I see it in the Bible. Acts chapter 2, 3,000 people got saved. How do you know 3,000 people got saved if they're not saying, hey, guess what, I'm going to put my faith in Jesus, right? They counted. You know, God, I get God doesn't care about numbers. I get that to a degree, but God does care about numbers. 3,000 got saved the first day, right? And they publicly profess faith in Jesus. So God blesses public profession. He does. And it also allows those around you to say, hey, you know what? I can be praying for them. I can be holding them accountable in love. I can be an encourager to them. First, I want to just ask this, man. Maybe you're here today and you've never put your faith in Jesus for salvation. When he took your place on the cross and he paid your penalty for sin in full upon the cross. And he offers everlasting life simply by faith in him and the work of the cross. Maybe you're here today and you say, I've never put my faith in Jesus for eternal salvation. Would you raise your hand with me if you're ready to do that? Anybody here need to make that decision? Hey, I'm ready to put my faith in Jesus. I'm ready to put my faith in Jesus, the work of the cross. Not my own good deeds anymore. I'm not going to try to earn salvation. I can't do that. I put my faith in Jesus. Anybody here need to do that? And I know we didn't bow our heads or turn the lights off. We do have a keyboard guy playing. All right, I'm going to assume everybody in here has put their faith in Jesus. If you haven't, it's a bad thing to resist God. You want to make life really hard? Resist God. I know from personal experience. But maybe you're in here today and you have put your faith in Jesus. I'm going to assume everybody has now. Praise the Lord for that. I rejoice in that. Amen? Amen. The body of Christ, man. What's your next step? Maybe it's devoting yourself to a daily prayer life. Maybe it's devoting yourself to the study of God's Word. Maybe it's a commitment to a small group. Or being a witness to that coworker or classmate. What's your next step? Maybe it's repenting of sin. Maybe it's, hey, look, man, I've gotten sloppy. I've slacked off. Like David going up on the roof and seeing Bathsheba. He should have been at war. Maybe you should be at war and you haven't been. And you say, you know what? I need to repent of that. That's the next step, man. So maybe the Lord's put a next step on your heart. Would you raise your hand with me? Any next steps? Amen. Keep it up when you put it up for me. Next steps. Come on. Next steps. Yes. Amen. Next steps for Jesus. Right? Next steps for Jesus. Amen. Let's pray. Father, first, Lord, we want to thank you for the gospel. The truth, the gospel truth that you paid the price of my sin 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary. You lived a life that I can never live. And you died the death that I deserve. And I put my faith in you. Not in my works, not in my own righteousness, but I put my faith in you alone. And right now, Lord, we've had many in here profess they're ready to take their next step. So, Lord, I ask right now, we ask collectively that you would pour your Spirit out upon us in power. Pour your Spirit out upon us fresh and in power, God. And we receive by faith. Give us strength. Give us courage. That we would see these next steps to fruition. Lord, I lift up every marriage. I lift up every high school student, college student, every single, every child. Let's pray you have your hand upon them, God. Bless them. Work in their life. Work in them and through them. That the church would be built up for the work of the ministry. We love you, Lord. We thank you, God, for meeting us here today, speaking to our hearts, unctioning us to follow after you. And Lord, you said to be your disciple, we must deny ourselves, take up our cross daily, and follow after you. And Lord, we all proclaim in one accord, today we deny our flesh, we pick up a cross, and we follow after you. Thank you, Lord, for meeting us in this place. We pray it in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, look, if you made a decision today, I encourage you more than anything else to let somebody know. Share in detail the decision you made today. Find an accountability partner. Get connected in a small group. I'd like to invite you to come forward after I leave the stage to come forward for prayer. I'd love to pray with you. There's going to be prayer teams on either side of the church. Go there and get some prayer and let them know what you've made a decision for. That's awesome. It's awesome. Also, I'd love to see you at my table. Come see me. Say hey to me. Love to pray with you out there. And God bless you guys. I pray you've been blessed by the message. And I hope to see you in a minute. God bless you.
Let's stand together and sing this chorus again.
And you reign above it all. You reign above it all. Over the universe and over every yard, there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and the earth erupt in songs and sing hallelujah to the everlasting one, because there is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. So let all of heaven and the earth erupt in song and sing hallelujah to the everlasting one. There is no higher name. Jesus, you reign above it all. Oh, you reign above it all.
You believe he reigns this morning? Give him one more shout of praise today. Amen. Why don't we show some honor and give it up again for Mr. Ebo Elder bringing a word. We appreciate you, brother. God bless you. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys so much, and I know Pastor Ebo just did a phenomenal job, as he did in the first service, but please stop by his merch table on your way out. He's got his new book, The Great Comeback, back there, t-shirts that say Jesus Strong on them. Y'all please check that out. All that helps his ministry, and this is something that we did. We believe in other churches, amen? We do. I mean, we know what it's like to start from scratch, to start from zero, and Pastor Ebo, God has called him back to Newnan, Georgia, and they're going to be planting a church starting from scratch. They don't even have a building yet, hadn't even had the first service yet, but they know that's what God's called them to do. So we know what that's like, and we want to believe in him. We want to pray for them, most importantly. But if you feel led today, as we exit here in a moment, I have a few announcements, and then I'll pray, and then we'll exit. But if you feel led to, after the service, this one offering plate right here, you can just make it out to Northridge Church, and at the bottom put Ebo, E-B-O, and that's going to go to 100% to help him start his church, to 100% that church plant. They're looking for a building. They're looking for a facility to have a meeting space. So we want to believe in God with them. We want to encourage them. We want to root for them. So this will be an extra love offering for Ebo to help start his church. So if you feel led to do that after we pray, please come down here and give it right here. That'd be awesome. Real Talk Wednesdays are our current Wednesday night series for the adults. Pastor Mark taught last week, and this whole series is about just educating our parents, helping our parents be better adults, better grandparents, better influences on our kids. But we talked about sex trafficking, child exploitation last week, and the dangers of that. This week we're talking about social media. The next week we're talking about how to prepare our kids for God's calling, whether that be straight into the workforce or into college, and how to pay for college debt free. So really want to equip our parents and challenge our parents during the series to come. But that's on Wednesdays. Special guest is Sergeant Jesse Hambrick this upcoming Wednesday. It's going to be great. Next Sunday is our baby dedication service. So if you have a little one that was born here in the last few years, maybe hadn't had the time for a dedication, we usually do that around Mother's Day, but obviously we couldn't this year because of COVID. But we're going to have our baby dedication next week. You can go online, northridgethomason.com, and you can fill that out underneath the tabs of events. You can fill out a form for your child to be dedicated next week. And last but not least, We've done this for the last 2 years in a row in November, what we call our harvest offering. This is separate from our tithes. This is above and beyond that. This is not in our general budget, but we focus in on something, what God's called us to do for that year. For the last 2 years, we've been given to go toward our children's building. Praise God, our new children's building. We paid for it cash. No debt on that. It's a beautiful building. Amen. Big shout out to my boy Tyler. Pastor Tyler with the Awana Ministry, that has been going great, anywhere from 40 to 70 on a Wednesday night with our Awana Ministry. So we're super excited we were able to pay for that building cash, but that came from the harvest offering. Again, that's something separate above and beyond our tithes. That's just an extra giving moment, and that's coming up in 2 weeks. We've been praying about that as a staff, so we do have a couple pictures I want to show you. One is we believe that us having a 15-passenger van here on our campus will be something that we'll be able to utilize and for function for all of our ministries, specifically though for our youth ministry and children's ministry. Pastor Cody has a lot of kids on Wednesday nights that want to come, amen, that don't have a ride, so obviously we'll deck it out with the Northridge logo and things, but that van, used, good used van, it's about 20 grand for that van, anywhere from a 2017 to a 2018 is what we're looking at. It'll have 70 to 100,000 miles, but 20 grand for that nice 15-passenger van, that'll be used for all ministries, but specifically for our kids. Let's get them up here, let them hear the gospel. And then one other thing that'd be really fun we want to do, it'll cost about $10,000, so our goal is $30,000. That's what it's been for the last 2 years. We've taken that up. So the next goal will be another 10, so it'll be 20 plus 10 will be the 30, will be an outdoor, really nice half-court basketball court that'll go behind the youth building. We're going to create a big slab out there, a big 8-foot black chain link fence, a really nice pro slam dunkable goal. Getting the teenagers up here early before church. We'll have lights out there as well so kids can play in the evening time. So that'll be something really cool to utilize, to minister to kids, get them up here early, let them hang out and have fun. So the van plus the basketball goal and that whole court, it'll be about $30,000. So please be praying about what you can do, what you're able to do. That's going to be on November the 22nd, two Sundays from today, separate from our tithes. That's an additional offering that we'll do for our harvest offering this year, and we're super excited about that. And you may be thinking, well, Pastor David, last year, we had a challenge, and we were told that if we met our goal, that the staff would do a performance. Just so you know, that's happening that day as well. November 22nd, live on stage, something about some Old Town Road. But it's a little Christian remix, by the way. But our pastors are giving it 100%, baby. We're giving 100% on that morning, November the 2nd. So we're asking for you to give 100% because we're going to keep our word and we're going to do a little performance. It's going to be fun. So, and last but not least, I just saw Miss Tracy wave an envelope at me back there. That's for our Christmas show tickets, because online they're like $20. If you get them here, they're $15. David Crowder's coming to the Ridge, New Song's coming to the Ridge, and Matt Brock from Elevation Worship. They will all be here the first Sunday in December, December the 6th, okay? So get your tickets right outside at the welcome desk. Go see Miss Tracy. It'll save you $5, all right? God bless you. Let's pray. And then if you guys want to come invest in Ebo's ministry, please come if you feel led to do so. Lord Jesus, we love you. We thank you for loving us. We pray for Pastor Mark as he's traveling the roads and flying, Lord, preaching all over the world. We thank you, God, for him and his leadership. We thank you, God, for his relationship with Pastor Ebo, and Ebo being able to come in and bless us this morning with his testimony. What a powerful story that was, God, for us to never give up. And God, we thank you, Lord, for that great comeback, that we received that power from you. God, I pray for his ministry, for the church they're going to be starting up in Hogansville, Georgia. God, I pray, Lord, that these funds that we're able to give, Lord, would just help further that kingdom work, Lord Jesus. And God, we thank you again so much for what you're doing here. We give you all the honor. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, if you're blessed this morning, somebody say amen. Amen. You're dismissed. Thank you so much.